Trilogy is one of those episodes that sticks with you for its blend of sci-fi and morbid slash gleeful horror. Out of all the stories from the original series, this is definitely among the most memorable for me. The feeling I was left with after watching it for the first time was just unsettling, especially with how they orchestrated the tone of the ending. It was written by Charles Beaumont and based on his 1953 short story of the same name. Douglas Hayes returned to direct the second of his 9 episodes to air, and it stars Jeff Morrow, Kevin Hagen, Don Dubbins, and 2-time Academy Award nominee Cecil Kellaway. Carl Myers, James Webber, and Peter Kirby are astronauts that have been lost in space since a meteor shower knocked out some of their navigation equipment 6 months ago, that being in September of 2185. They land on an asteroid said to be 655 million miles away from the Earth. They're surprised to see the asteroid has a breathable atmosphere and even looks like Earth did 200 years prior. But the most bizarre distinction of this floating rock are the people. They stand posed as if they're living a regular day of life, but don't move or respond to anything the astronauts do. They walk throughout this small town, confused to see more and more people in the same state until a man named Jeremy Wickwire comes alive to welcome them to his house. The truth of what's really going on is even more strange than the trio could imagine. The creep factor of this episode is off the charts. The scenes of these rooms filled with people who don't move are just plain freaky. And yes, since they use real actors who had to remain still, it's not perfect. Small movements are visible in almost every sequence they're in, but it's not too distracting, and I'm glad they went with real people instead of mannequins or dummies. Director Douglas Hayes planned a strategy to minimize the noticeable twitches of his actors by constantly moving the camera. It works sometimes, but outside of that purpose, I love those shots. It really gives a sense of scale to the environments and helps make the look of the episode more distinct. Hayes also made a big decision by replacing the auto race scene that was in the original short story with the beauty pageant sequence. He thought the former wouldn't translate well to the screen and look too much like parked cars. Charles Beaumont was said to be upset with this change, but for a lot of people, the pageant scene is one of the more memorable parts of the episode. The acting here, while not the centerpiece, is pretty good. All three leads have defining characteristics that make them view the situation from slightly different perspectives. The mystery of what this place is carries their reactions to believable expressions of confusion and frustration, specifically when dealing with Mr. Wickwire.
Now I understand.
Well, that's nice. We don't.
This is one of my favorite twists, so I'm giving you some extra warning here. I think you should check this out if you haven't seen it before. Believe me, it's worth it. Through their conversation with Wickwire, we hear that the astronauts are out of fuel and have to stay on the asteroid. There's also more background information that comes out about the state of the Earth.
Did they ever have that atomic war?
Yes, in 1985. Most of the Earth's surface was destroyed, and it's taken us 200 years to pick up the pieces.
After that, we finally find out what this place is.
Where are we? Why, you're in a cemetery.
Apparently, this was an extension of Earth's greatest mortuary called Happy Glades, where after death, the rich can be embalmed and placed into their greatest fantasy forever.
In other words, this is the place where your dreams come true. After you've stopped dreaming.
Opened in 1973, only a select few on the asteroid are actually dead. The rest are called human imitations. Mr. Wickwire then reveals himself as a scientific device that only turns on when needed, and he hasn't been activated in around 200 years.
Happy Glades promises eternal peace, everlasting peace. You couldn't have that on Earth, now could you?
Earlier, he gave them wine to toast with that is revealed to actually be eternifying fluid, an embalmer that kills its ingester and makes them like the other people on the asteroid.
I told you not to trust him! I told you!
When Myers asks why he's done this to them, Wickwire responds it's because they've disturbed the everlasting peace of the dead on the asteroid, and also because they are men.
And while there are men, there can be no peace.
Before their deaths, Wickwire asked the trio what their dearest wish would be. All three answered to be on their ship heading for home, and that's exactly where we see them after they're dead. Wickwire poses them on their spacecraft as if they're about to take off. He nonchalantly dusts them before returning to his home to deactivate. And that's how this episode ends. What a macabre, horrifying finish. The astronauts are murdered and their bodies posed like wax figures forever. And the thing that really puts this over the top is the goofy, lighthearted music they play while Wickwire dusts their corpses. Goodness gracious! Cold-blooded, man! Cold-blooded! The theme of nuclear war and mankind being the cause of its own demise is covered more than a few times in this series, and it's mostly in the background here till the end. Wickwire would make a great movie villain. Think about it, a humanoid artificial intelligence that runs a planet of peacefully placed dead people, a being that believes as long as man lives, there can be no peace. His goal would be a noble one in his own mind, to give us all what we want, but only in death. Someone should make another character like this. What a great idea. Credit to Charles Beaumont for crafting such a motivation and Douglas Hayes for bringing him to life. This is an obvious recommendation, even if some of the science doesn't make sense, but who cares? Go seek this out and watch it. Elegy is forever frozen in time, and we could take a trip to see it in all its glory whenever we want, inside that living memory that is the Twilight Zone.